to go to Alyssa now, listening in Seattle, Washington on Sacred Heart Radio. Hi, Alyssa. Welcome to the program.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call.
You got it.
My question is more about church history, early church history,
good,
than it is the Crusades. But there's some dispute in some church history between the East and the West, of course. And what I'm specifically wondering is if you have any information on the claim by the East that in the year 879, Pope John VIII signed a declaration at a council that was held supposedly in Constantinople saying that the Nicene Creed couldn't be altered, which was then contradicted in the year 1054, as we know, which caused the schism. I'm wondering if you have any information on that and how I could refute that to someone who's interested in Orthodoxy.
Yeah, so Alyssa, thanks for that question. So the disagreement between East and West over the filioque clause, and to kind of give sense to that for people who might not know what we're talking about, so to give a little background. So you have this council that takes place called the Council of Nicaea in the year 325. It's principally called to address a major heresy that's going on in the church at the time called the Arian heresy. So Arius was a North African priest who, in trying to answer the question, who is Jesus, and try to come up with the terminology of how we discuss and describe who Jesus is, he kind of posited the heresy that Jesus was a creature of God, that he wasn't actually co-eternal, or as we say now in the creed, consubstantial with the Father, that he was this most first perfect creature of God. So Arius's heresy became very popular and widespread, and so to counteract that, the church called, actually the Emperor Constantine called, and the church participated in this council known as the Council of Nicaea, and one of the outcomes of that council was the creation of this creed that we call the Nicene Creed, and that we recite still at every Mass. And so as you move forward in church history, what ends up happening is that a large portion of the Western world is actually converted to this Arian form of Christianity, because even though the council was called, the creed was proclaimed, this heresy persists, and it really persists in the East. And you have Eastern Arian missionaries leave the East and go to the West, and some of the Germanic barbarian tribes on the outskirts of the Roman Empire, they actually convert to Arianism. And that all leads up to the point where we get to in Spain. I think it was in the 6th century in Spain, there's a local church council that gathers that describes, is trying to deal with a lot of these ethnic German barbarians and their adoption of Arianism as opposed to Orthodox Catholicism. And so one of the ways in which the bishops of the council decide to deal with this is they add a clause in the creed that's known as the filioque. And what that is it's when it talks about the Holy Spirit, that we say that Jesus, or that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. And that last part, and the Son, is the filioque. That is not present in the original creed from the Council of Nicaea. And so the Easterners, over as we advance through church history, many Eastern churches and Eastern Orthodox today still have issues with the fact that the church added that clause first at this local council, and then later on was promulgated for usage throughout the universal church, the Catholic Church. They have issues with the fact that that creed was changed. And it was changed because of this very specific pastoral issue associated with these Arian barbarians. And there's been a lot of work done recently, in the last couple of years actually, of theological discussions between both East and West on how we can come to agreement on it. And in many central ways, the theological principle behind that statement, we both agree on. It's still, I think many people in the East still have issues with the fact that the creed was changed, thinking that the church didn't have authority to do that. And that's really kind of the basis of the disagreement. But theologically, most of the disagreement has gone away, actually.
Yeah, and we've seen recent popes, I think of the great work of Pope Benedict in this area, really doing so much to bridge relations between the East and the West, meeting with very many patriarchs from the East and really some real positive developments there. What would you say about some of the stuff that's been going on recently in terms of trying to bridge the divide between East and West, Steve?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you mentioned, Pope Benedict the 16th, but also, most impressively during the pontificate of St. John Paul II. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He was very much focused on trying to unify, as he called it, the two lungs of the church.
Right.
He said that the church had to breathe with both lungs, East and West.
Yeah.
And he, wrote an encyclical on unity and how, and even offered to bring in kind of how the question of how the Pope exercises his pastrine ministry, if there's a way in which that can be, you know, exercised in a manner that would make it possible for the Eastern Orthodox to come back into union with the Church, he was open and willing to do that. So the Church has really made a lot of outreach in the last several pontificates to try to solve this issue.
Yeah, and that's a very, very good point about ut unum sint, that they may be one, you know, that the Pope wasn't just speaking to Protestants saying, you know, how could a Petrine ministry serve you, but, you know, to the Orthodox as well. That was certainly in John Paul II's mind, for sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah, great.